always.
So good morning, everybody again. Now it's me who has to present a great college, good friend. I'm not going to be able to present him in the way because he's much more than he say about me. And we are this morning in this last presentation of this summer course on strengthening European identity through culture and education and how to manage it. Well, it doesn't mean we are going to finish on coffee because, as you know, we had debate and conclusions later, but this is the last academic presentation of today. The topic of today was new tendencies on cultural cooperation and management in the European and international initiative. We talked this morning about European cultural roots, and now we have Steve Austin, which is the director of the MBA Culture, Heritage and Citizenship Project and member of the Netherlands Business Academy and permanent fellow of the Felix Meritis Foundation. And he titled his speech for today, "The Pyramid Model, a Scenario of Development of Project-Based Organizations to Get Continuity." So Steve, we wait very much again for your lessons because you always teach us a lot. So the floor is yours. Thank you very much once again.
Thank you, Miguel. We tried to add some slides to those I prepared, but our own technical facilities are not really up to date. So that pictures will be for the next time we will meet here or in Kursk or in Amsterdam or elsewhere. I want to go back with you to the first day of this week. And there we had the keynote speech of Abraham de Zwaan. And he started to tell us that he, in fact, doesn't know what the definition of Europe is. I recall he said, it's not a nation, it's not a federation, it probably is a confederation. And later on, I told you, it is not a confederation either. It's something completely new in the history of the development of political sovereign bodies. And you are very lucky today because on the 1st of November at the celebration of the 25 years of the Treaty of Maastricht, 1992, that was in fact the start of a new definition of Europe. Europe was no longer a union of member states. As before, the name changed from European Economic Community into European Union, which is a union of member states and citizens. So this, of course, led finally to the Lisbon Treaty, where the rights of the individual citizens are guaranteed and have to be implemented in the policies of all 27 member states. This process is going on, but the problem to tell people who are not living in the EU, or people who are living in the EU, what is it in political and juridical terms, that until now was not solved. So you are very lucky that I can give you an insight in the keynote speech that will be held on the 25th anniversary of the Treaty of Maastricht, in Maastricht, the 1st of November next, by my good friend Jaap Hoeksma. Jaap Hoeksma is a philosopher of law who once worked for the High Commissioner for Refugees at United Nations, and all of a sudden he decided, I have to quit, I have to devote my knowledge and my personal citizenship to Europe. So he started on his own as a private person, a kind of research institute, and now, 25 years later, his theory of the democratic integration, which has to integrate the citizens with the union as a union of states and citizens, it has been accepted by leading politicians as well as scholars, and now he is invited to openly present his theory on the 1st of November in Maastricht. What is, in short, this theory? What is the difference with existing notions of state building, of definition of political entities? The theory of democratic integration analyzes the EU from the citizens' perspective of democracy and the rule of law. There we are underlining Miguel's argumentation. The rule of law is the red line that should be respected by all citizens and governments of member states. Otherwise, you have to step out. This, of course, is not enough to convince everybody to keep the promises and to work together along the lines of Lisbon. The new theory will help politicians and citizens to come to conclusions. In practical terms, the theory of democratic integration reveals that the European Union currently is evolving from an organization of democratic states, because you can't become a member if you are not democratic in yourself, following the rule of law and the values that Europe has defined in the Treaty of Lisbon. So, an organization of democratic states will now change towards a democratic union of states and citizens. While international organizations neither have citizens nor democratic aspirations, the evolution of the European Union has reached the point on which the European Union may be defined as a union of states and citizens, in which the citizens are entitled to participate both in the national democracies of their countries and in the democratic, in the common democracy of the Union. On a theoretical level, democratic integration introduces the Maastrichtian model of transnational relations. What is important? If this definition is being not only accepted but spreads through the European institutions, then it will be completely clear that it can't be compared with the United Nations, which a lot of Americans think European Union, you should look to it as if it was such a thing as United Nations. And we know United Nations can adopt declarations, but they can't punish member states that are not following their rules. The European Union, however, through this theory of democratic integration, does have this right and should use it, according to Miguel, myself, and a lot of other people. So, to underline the new developments, to criticize the Polish government for changing the legal practice and criticizing the Hungarian government for not following the principles of European values is fully in line with the definition of a democratic integration, which in fact says if only democratic states can become members and their citizens are also members of this union, then the union must be democratic too. There is no other result possible. And then the decisions of this entity, of this union, have to lead to measurements, as in any democratic organization. So, you are the first to hear this. You will hear more about it, but you can tell people who say, hey, did you hear? They have found out what it is. You can say, we know that. We have solved that problem at Juste at the end of September. So, I'd like to start with this novelty, which proves another aspect that was mentioned days before. The individual citizen has the responsibility to deliver the utmost power within him, his or her capacity, to take part in the democratic process and to make it more democratic than before. So this, it worked? Oh, yeah. Fantastic. You see individual citizens working together. Although the computer has crashed, okay. This Jaap Hoeksma proves that stepping out of his luxury job at United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees and going home to do his personal research can be beneficial through networking, through sending in your comments, visiting commissioners, going to members of parliament, and so on. And you can do that too. He never made money out of it. His wife is an academic, so they can live from her salary. Always important, try to find out where the money comes from. In this case, Jaap's achievements and Jaap's influence in the policy-making process is financed by his wife. Okay, what did Jaap more? He did one thing more, and that leads to the topic of today. He thought this is such a theoretical endeavor. I have convinced international academic circles, I have published, they liked it, but I have to find a way to get as many young Europeans hooked to this phenomena. How can I do that? He invented a board game, is it the right word? So on paper, a board game, like Monopoly. But now it is not Monopoly, it's Europoly. And he is regularly playing that game with the highest classes of the gymnasia in the Netherlands. He is invited by the school, and then they play with, in small groups, this game. And the game is how to become the president of Europe. Of course, there is no president, but the game makes fun, because on the way to become the winner, you do find out how the European Union works to have the maximum influence in the policy-making process. It would be a nice idea next, just a meeting to have Jaap here with five or six of his games, and you will play all how to become the president of Europe. This was along the lines of, can certain artistic expression, certain academic notions reach a wider audience? This is one of the examples. The other is cultural roots, and we have listened to the festival lady who gave a long list of activities which are not purely meant for an audience that likes to come to artistic expressions. Through the launching of this board game, he did it in the European Parliament with the first thing he presented to, at that time, the more or less president of the European Union. And he managed that CNN was there and made a 10 minutes special out of it. And now he has to convince CNN that they come to have the necessary addendum, which is, for this and this reason, the European Union per se is a democratic entity that has the right to use their power to kick out those who are not following the rules, completely contrary with the United Nations practice. And you, as upcoming specialist, should use these kinds of notions. And now we go to the practical thing. You have seen this slide, which I want to show you again, because Cultural Roots, the festival presentation, to a certain extent, the marketing pictures from Jan, they all have one thing in common, which is the aspiration that the activities will not end by the presenting of the product, or the presenting of the show, or the presenting of the cultural good. There must be, we learned from Jan, a mission. Where are we going to? Why are we doing this? Is the festival there to present a play to an audience that likes the play? Fine, but why should they do that? And this is where this upcoming curriculum of the MBA, European Culture Heritage Citizen, has to lead to. We want to make clear that in nowadays Europe, every institution who is dealing with education or culture, every individual citizen who spends time in setting up new initiatives or projects should ask him or herself the question, why are we doing this? Why is just renovated? Why are we doing academic activities? Yes, to educate people, yes, but why? Because we think that we have a certain responsibility for the development of civil society, that finally the citizens are the power that are going to structure Europe. Top down must be there, but not without a consensus within society. And this means another mindset in the boardrooms of universities, of festivals, of cultural institutions, of libraries, and of civic organizations too, and of a lot of people. There is the right, of course, free speech, which includes the right to complain. But the right to complain does not lead to minder the complaints. It's nice, but I expect from you that you take part in the argumentation game, why you take a responsibility for Europe and what should be your role in making it better and to develop a communication with your surrounding. And therefore, we think that festivals, cultural institutions, and academic institutions are not ready to do that now. They are not ready to make clear in all their activities, we are part of a new democratic something. So we take responsibility for the democratic developments because we are part of civil society and the citizens who pay taxes. They want to live in a democratic society, so we have to do more to bind them, to inform them, and to support them in their endeavors to take new initiatives. But therefore you need tools, and our opinion is that we can learn from the business sector. And you have heard Jan. Everything Jan presented has to be in the mindset of the leaders of these institutions, festivals, academic, and so on and so on, because otherwise they are spreading incomplete solutions. We are living in a liberal democracy based on a, say, continental capitalistic practice. It's not a copy of the Anglo-Saxon model. No, it is a social, liberal, capitalistic system. So therefore, not only the business people should know how to have good leadership and how to have convincing marketing techniques. No, it should be in the heads of any responsible person who is ready to take the lead in any kind of organization. Of course, the difference is that in certain commercial institutions in business, you have to pay attention to the wishes of the shareholders. We are talking about stakeholders. And then you see the immense responsibility of a university board, because the stakeholders are not only the students, but it's the entire society. And this society should recognize your university as a platform for democratic exchange and for building up a stronger civil society and a better understanding of the individual power of the individual citizen to make a success of this Europe, which nowhere else in the world is existing in this democratic form. But then you can take into consideration, additional to Jan's words, there are certain aspects for the cultural sector, including the educational sector, since they have the luxury not to work for shareholders, but they have the responsibility to work for stakeholders. And that means that they have to adapt certain, not principles, but certain practices that make it possible to get continuity. So not driving on making the maximum money, but striving towards continuity. Only in continuity you can keep as many interested active citizens and take them with you during a couple of years, generations, and so on. But then you have to pay attention to Jan's recipe for change, which is absolutely necessary for any organization, and not too many universities or cultural organizations are ready to adapt to the present time. So, not ready for change. And this change is necessary because the voters, the citizens, want it. So, this is the marketplace where any organization is dealing with. And talking about festivals, I know festivals that are glad if they reach the frequent visitor, the regular one, and hopefully they do invest in attracting the occasional one. But that means that you are only serving a particular part of society. And it could be that this part of society is the part that already knows where to go, what the message is, and so on. But in my opinion, you should include those parties, those colleagues, those entities that are hostile to you. So the lesson is, if you are going for change, persons in your staff and yourself should first invest in the relations with the hostile surroundings and then work from out inside. A dialogue without fighting is essential to have a fruitful civil society. Why should you think I am the best here in Extremadura and they are doing stupid things? Let them where they are. No, you have to talk to them. It is your responsibility. You can have different opinions, but you have to blame yourself if you at least were not capable to find out why you have different practices and different opinions. Another thing that has to be taken into account, if some of you are in a couple of years leading a scientific organization or an NGO or whatever, and if you have, in your opinion, you are popular and you are doing a good job, find out which age group is visiting you. You probably will find out that your popularity is very close to one or two certain age groups. But what will happen if this age group grows older? What you see in the cultural sector, especially in popular festivals and cultural centers, that they are very popular in the beginning. Youngsters are coming there, people who don't have already built a family, though they have a lot of time, and they want to meet, they want to find other people for different reasons. They are not coming to you because your concert is the best in Europe. They are coming there for the cultural climate, which includes to find partners, which includes to find people to talk to. So here you have an American sociological analysis of the nine phases in a person's life. So if a newly married couple is visiting your institution, it's your task to keep them with new activities, with a programming which is not necessarily the heart of your activities. You have to keep them until they are solitary survivors, because then they will go to their lawyer and tell him, you must give all my money to this fantastic festival, because you have created a ring of confidence which is needed to get more and more your message spread, which includes notions of values and democratic practices. So we know from popular music centers that they can, because certain trends in music, they can be packed 2-3 years and then all of a sudden they are empty. Because this age group is going to marry, all of them, practically, then all of them get children and they are no more coming to your organization. So Miguel, with his cultural roots, has to pay attention to this. He has to be attractive for all nine age groups, and the interaction within families or factories or schools between the age groups must be taken into account. And your changed marketing plan has to support all kinds of actions to have that happen. A young friend of us, of Linda and me, a journalist from Belgrade, after the civil war in Yugoslavia, he wanted to do something for his age group. And he started to go into an empty factory. In fact, the only building now where Dimitar was telling us that real estate developers are coming to the bank of the River Sava to buy all these old factories. It's also thanks to the success of his initiative in this abandoned factory that another kind of people is visiting and is finding out that this bank is fantastic. So he, Dejan Ubovic, he came to Amsterdam to us to have a talk, and we showed these kind of mechanics. So he started immediately a second program, not only an evening program with exhibitions, bands, motor shows and so on, but also a daily program for young families with kids. And then he started a kind of a collective shop for crafts work for those who don't have a job and have to stay at home for some reason, but can make products for the craft shop, and so on, and so on, and so on. And then you are building around your entity and around your leadership, because people like him, of course, because he took the initiative, a bunch of activities which are interconnected, and also from the business point of view, if the one is going down, the others can keep you upright. It is, of course, not as romantic as I tell you, but you will find out. And that is what you will find out. This is the life cycle for any organization, from the business type, as well as from the, say, stakeholders model. The pioneer, the initiator, can keep the thing to a maximum of 7 years. After that, you need people who have another capacity because they have to secure the continuity, and continuity of an existing thing that is rather young is something completely different than pioneering. And after this consolidation phase, that say 10 years time, then you have to go for the change that Jan promoted here, because otherwise you become old-fashioned before you know. And then you can only blame yourself for being so convinced about your own capacities. Because, as Jan said, you can't have any result without an interaction with the citizens who want to belong to your community. And then we are talking about networking. It's not new, but networking is very interesting nowadays, because anybody who have access to internet is using it. So use it, select those individuals you met here the last 5 days you want to stay in contact with, exchange information, probably set up smaller initiatives. That is all through the horizontal way, without any money involved. And the new asset in the modern times is not money, but time. So take care that you are not spoiling your time, because it is your asset to set up businesses through networking. The networking we are talking about in this democratic Europe is not the networking of the mafia type, which is also networking, or the network of oil companies, or the network of pipeline diggers. No, this is something else. This is the person-to-person networking. And therefore, a list of criteria could be checked before you go doing serious business with an organization that claims to be a network. Emancipation, of course, that is the tool you use to reach your goal to be of added value to the European processes. It's, of course, across borders. It's non-dogmatic. It is not a political party. So the network of social democrats in Europe is not a network in this sense, because they exclude Christian democrats. That's clear. It is horizontal. And the credibility must be respected and underlined. I think it's clear for everybody. The benefits, yes, there are benefits, commercial benefits, although you don't invest money. Job rotation through the networking capacity, at least through my access to certain networks, I receive every 2 weeks at least one job description in various fields. And I distribute that to those in other networks which I think are interested in it. So the job rotation can be that you inform your friends, but it also can be that you yourself are sometime invited to work somewhere else, not precisely to earn money, but to take part in another project, and you get a badge and food. That is the beginning of an international career, because all these endeavors can be put on your CV. And so it works sometimes. So in the organization Linda and me have set up, we had every year at least 3 or 4 Erasmus students for a internship. And out of that, an Italian guy who after that could stay on, we did find some money for him. He now is the co-director of an international educational organization based in Amsterdam. Another one has set up her own business. She is from Scotland, and there are more. And if not through their internship, mostly these internships are mostly needed in the front of house, needed in direct contact with the clients. It's a fantastic opportunity to invest in your own new regular job by being professional, talkative, open to all these people you meet. The language, of course, in these kind of internships, is the working language is English. There you see what it can bring. finally you find yourself in a co-production position. You can't do it alone, you need other people, and through this process you do find them, and then all of a sudden your contacts are as many as needed to set up your first real international co-production, in whatever form, be it as the people from the we saw working in South America in the local projects, be it an artistic project, or be it an educational one, or be it to set up a route of something else. This is all within your capacity. So, a civic network, networking is and was a civic activity. The citizens of Florence who started a university before, as you heard from Miguel, starting universities was a privilege of the nobility, the king or the duke. They started universities in 1457. Citizens took the initiative, active citizens like you. And this was much later the case in Amsterdam in the institution Linda and me re-changed into a center for cultural activity, debate, courses, and so on. That was in the period of Dutch Enlightenment, so the Enlightenment in the Netherlands came much later. But that are just examples. In this period, orphan houses and societies, insurance companies, social welfare institutions were initiated by citizens. Now it is all state or even privatized, but it started with the initiative of individuals. They wanted to do good for their community. And if you happen to come to Amsterdam once, there is now, in one of these former orphan houses, which is a museum now, Hermitage in Amsterdam, co-production with Leningrad, there is a whole department full of paintings where all these clubs of citizens are painted. So you can see who, in fact, which citizens have set up this orphan house, this Charité, this infirmary, and so on, this school, this university. It is nothing new, the treaty of Lisbon citizenship agenda gives a new paradigm. We go through it to the pyramid model. What I wanted to show you, if you look to your activity, be it that you are organizing once a month a shared breakfast at McDonald's with friends you want to talk to, that is a cultural activity, you could use this pyramid to place that somewhere in your ambition agenda. What do I want to reach? If you want to reach to play a significant role in enlightening your surroundings to promote citizenship, then you probably will place in the top a few friends of you who are specialists, academics, intellectuals, who like to come for free on their own cost to join your coffee table. And if you go through this way of thinking, then you do realize that if I finally want to reach the wider community, I need formats, not the coffee table. I probably need to associate with a festival where a lot of people are coming, and they probably like me to present a few performances which are dealing with the European values, the European dream, or the European obsession. And in between all these formats from the top, which is an elite think tank, to the bottom, which is, for instance, the cultural roots of Jan, there is a lot in between that, without much money, but with a lot of investing time, can be realized. Of course, well-funded festivals can do that more easy, and they should do, like the festival we saw yesterday. And I have the impression that they are doing that. They are not only having the performances, but they also have a summer university. They have, I think, they make video productions and so on and so on to attract with the same content another area of interested citizens. So this is empty, you can use it for your own purposes. Here you see an example that Linda and me used, and that was very satisfactory. You see from top down is the complexity coefficient. The more complex, the higher you get in the pyramid, but for this this complexity for every stage you need a different format. So if Linda has a globalization lecture where a famous academic from the States is coming, then of course the hall is packed with students from the universities of Amsterdam and Utrecht, and that format can't be watered to please an audience which has less capacity to deal with complexity. But the theme, for instance, the necessity to change the pollution management or the water management can be offered on a lower level of the pyramid in another format to another group of interested citizens. There is one institution in Amsterdam who is following this model rather consequently, that is our partner Pakhuis de Zwijger. Non-subsidized, fully self-supporting, four halls, a former warehouse. The biggest room is 400 people, and then 200, 150, and so on. What they do is, if they have had this expert meeting in the top, which they could co-finance with academic partners, then finally they end up on the bottom with a local hero, so to speak, and then the entrance is free, but everywhere are electronic boxes where you can put your card in and you have to say, I like this. How much do I want to pay for it? And then they earn income without having the cost of a box office or a bookkeeper or a person at the door that has to control your tickets. And this is, of course, necessary in a period where money is less available for younger people, but time is also less available. But as long as you can make a priority list in your time spending ambitions, you can go there. My granddaughter, who is 21, she is in the meantime an international respected activist. She started, of course, locally, but for instance, Dimitar, she visited her in one of the last squatted houses, which were famous in Macedonia. But anyway, these social activities do cost time, and you have to live on something, so she has small jobs in a bar and so, but she can't afford to pay 15, 20 euro to go to such a speaker she loves to hear. Therefore, this is a good formula. So you have to combine the life cycle with your pyramid model, and then with the rules of the game in that age group. Then I made another. If you can, of course, if you want to be social active and political active, you also can fill in such a machine, which is in fact helping to train your brain machine in becoming a successful active citizen and an ambassador for the good without killing yourself. So that is not what we want. We want you to take decisions that are fruitful for you, for your direct friends and family and children, perhaps, for your society, for your community, but through that for the whole of Europe. If you don't mind, I will stop here. Questions?
That's what I wanted to say. Miguel is being interviewed, so he will join us in a few minutes. You can't leave the room if you are addressed so directly by the speech of Steve, which goes into also your personal and professional life. So where are the questions? I'll start with you. Yes.
Okay.
I have many questions, but first I would like to ask you a personal experience that you spend a lot of time working on this. So it's what was the main challenge that you have found in this, because this is really interesting, like combining business and economical background, but at the same time, you know, political, art, and social interest. So that's my question. I don't know if it is clear.
I'm happy to answer you. Nobody ever asked me how come. No, I was studying economics. At the time, it was called bedrijfseconomie. So, but in fact, business studies to run commercial organizations. But I was married. I first was in the army as at that time you had to go to the army. But I signed 3 months more to earn enough money to pay for my studies at the university in Amsterdam. And that 3 months was enough to cover 1 year. And I did hope after this year to have my exam, and that after that I could get a state loan for financing the rest of my study. This succeeded, but at the same time, I was investing in my family. That means my daughter was born 21 years ago. And nay, not, that's my granddaughter. She is 50, 54 or something. So I had to earn an extra money. There was full employment, so I was lucky in the beginning of the 60s. But I couldn't have a real job, so I accepted as a student in economics and finance, I accepted a part-time job in a showbiz organization to assist the bookkeeper. But after 3 days, it became clear that the showbiz organization was not prepared to organize the tours for a local artist who became in the Netherlands very famous because his song became number one at the Dutch list, music list. And I just had got my driver's license. So I put up my hand and said, I can organize that. Mm-hmm. I didn't know the guy. I hadn't drive a small van, but I... And of course there was nobody else, so I could hire this van and pick up this artist, and I came in the theaters, and then it came out that in the theaters there wasn't much organized because nobody at that time was prepared to receive a one-man show that was completely new, a solo singer with a band, 3 people. They were prepared for the traditional variété theater and things like that. So within 2 weeks, I was also very experienced in lighting, in sound, and in taking a nice dress with me to go in the intermission to the director to ask for the money, because otherwise you can wait for that. So to cut it short, during my studies, after 1 year, I established my first commercial firm, Steve Austin Unlimited. There were no limiteds at the time. You only could go for the unlimited. But to register that, you need a lot of money. I could lend that amount of money for 1 day. I showed it at the notaire, at the registration official. It was put there, and next day I took it out, and then I had my registration, and I was capable, therefore I did it. I did it to be capable to act legally in all countries of Europe.
What was the enterprise for?
To expand my activities, although I didn't know what they will be. So as a private person, you can't even, in your own country, you can't sell something because you are less reliable than a letterhead, Steve Austin Unlimited, for all your or whatever. That, so first lesson, change your natural identity into a legal body. The sooner the better. After 45, forget about it. Why? Because if you start young to have a legal body, then you will find out that the state, the fiscal institutions are subsidizing you. If you're a private person, then you know every 10 euro you earn, the state takes something. The money the state takes is it takes into account your life cycle. The state knows this guy will die when he is 80. He probably will want to go in pension. During his life, he needs so much money, so, and that are your taxes. Because you are a natural person, as a natural person, you die. As a legal body, you never die. Which means that the same amount of money that the state wants to get from you is per year in a legal body much, much lower, and there are a lot of subsidies, in fact, for business activity, because in an economic-driven country as the Netherlands, the slogan is one business attracts more business, attracts more consumers, attracts more taxes. So my message was at that time, I don't need subsidy because the tax authority is sponsoring me. And so I could develop my own showbiz firm by taking the artist out of his business. And I was, my last ten term for my BA, it is now, it was, I failed completely, and I thought this is the sign that I have to go in the showbiz business and no longer finish my study. So I did, and within a couple of years, I had five firms, all with a special ingredient. It was the management and touring company for this artist. It was a impresariat for all the upcoming songwriters and cabaretiers. They were all of my age, and there was nobody who wanted to do that. And a theater. The theater, of course, cost money that I compensated with the turnover, with the income from the singer artist. But finally, as soon as the theater was more or less known and a lot of people came, I stopped all the commercial activities at that level. Linda came in, for instance, and more of my good friends. And out of that, we made the European Cultural Center called Felix Meritus, in the building which is called Felix Meritus, which was erected by individual citizens for the sake of studying encounters, international activities, and music. So that is what we reinstalled, adapted to that times. And now we lost the building, finally, in during the crisis, real estate. It was not our own building. We rented it. It was no longer. The prices for real estate went sky high. The income of cultural organizations was going down, so we had to leave the building. But we always said the content, the software of these organizations built up in all these years is worth to use for other purposes. And in fact, we are here as the result of the exploitation of the immaterial goods, the immaterial heritage of our own private lives put into a legal body. That's a very short answer, I know. Satisfied?
Okay, if there is no
more question,
maybe we will have a debate after that.
Yes.
And it's coffee, we are already like 45 minutes late for the coffee. So we give a big clap to Steve and we continue later with the debate.